Chapter 17. I love God's Word so much I brought it with me today. I hope you brought yours today. I know we turn it on with all the apps and iPads and phones, and that's okay. But bring your Word today. Would you stand? I love God's Word because God's Word is full of truth. And the Bible says that the truth shall set you free. I'm afraid today that people don't want the truth. Even though it'll make you free, people don't want the truth. You don't want it. You don't want the preacher to go to you and say, hey, you're not living right. You're not supposed to talk to your wife that way. You know what? You shouldn't be letting your children bring that in the house or the church. You know what? You shouldn't be talking about that. Sir, you need to make things right. You've been running your mouth. And sir, you need to forgive. And ma'am, you need to get a better attitude because you're not displaying Christ whatsoever. Nobody wants what you're selling. What happened? That's the truth, right?
Amen.
Very few people now want a prophet of God or a man of God to get in your business when he's praying over you and speak things to you about how you're living.
Amen.
This is a Pentecostal church, isn't it?
Amen.
See, all those things right there are giants in our life. They're giants. They're hindrances. People get uncomfortable and say, you know what? You need to pay tithes. But see, some people don't pay tithes because it's just rebellion. You're like, ain't nobody going to tell me what to do. That's fine. That's fine. No, you're not going to listen to nobody. Then you're never going to get the truth. You're never going to be set free. And one day you're going to look up in eternal torment and go, I wish I would have listened. And it's more than paying tithes. Well, it's quiet today, but I'm telling you, God wants to move. I tell you, He does. He wants to move. He wants to do a work in your life. And so today, the truth is going to go forth. What are you going to do with it? Maybe today you're here and you're just consumed by worry. You're just worried. You can't sleep. You can't eat. You're physically sick. Fear's coming to your life. But the truth of the matter is God hasn't given us a spirit of fear. So if you have a spirit of fear, it's from the devil. It ain't from God. For God has not given a spirit of fear, but of love and power and a sound mind. You got some people got some power and some love, but their mind is messed up. It won't work. You got to have all three.
Amen.
I better get to preaching today. Hallelujah. 1 Samuel chapter 17. Let's read the first four verses, then we'll look at verse 16. We've been here twice since we've pastored here. And I've noticed something this week in this story. I love this story. In fact, I love reading about the stories of old because it increases and it builds my faith. It excites me and knows that God, if He did it then, He can do it now. If He did it for David, He can do it for me. If I'll just serve Him and love Him and worship Him and go after Him, He'll do the same for me. He'll do it for you. That's what the Bible says. I love you. Still love me? You got to get to heaven. Now the Philistines gathered their armies together to battle. And they were gathered at Shochah, which belongs to Judah. Did you catch that? The enemy is now occupying something that belonged to Judah. It ought not be so. What's the enemy occupying in your life that he's not supposed to occupy? Your mind? Your marriage? Your finances? Your children? Your television? Your internet? Your phone? Your job? And they encamped between Shochah and Ashkah in Ephah's Dimon. So they gathered there. Verse 2, and Saul and the men of Israel were gathered together and they were encamped in the valley of Elah. And they drew up in battle array against the Philistines. The Philistines stood on a mountain on one side, and Israel stood on a mountain on the other side, and notice, a valley between them. And a champion went out from the camp of the Philistines, named Goliath, from Gath, whose height was 6 cubits in a span. Some theologians say 9 foot tall, some say 10. He was a towering monster of a man. Verse 16. And the Philistine drew near and presented himself 40 days, morning and evening. Oh, most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, I know what I'm getting ready to speak is not my own word, for you spoke it to me last Monday. Lord, you reminded me Tuesday when we walked together as we prayed. Oh, God, I thank you, Lord. But now, Lord, I ask you, Lord, that it wouldn't be I that's preaching, but, Lord, that your anointing and the power of the Holy Ghost, Lord, that you would be the one speaking, that I would be just the watchman on the wall that's sounding the alarm. For if I sound not the alarm, their blood will be on my hands. But Lord, if I stand on the wall and I watch and I sound the alarm, the blood will be on their hands. And so, Lord, would you help me today? Lord, would you let your spirit move and pierce every heart that's troubled and broken and battered and lonely and confused, that heart that's blackened with sin, Lord, that heart that's worried and oppressed. Lord, those are giants in our life, and I pray today, God, that every giant would tumble. God, I pray faith would increase and hope would rise and revival would come and souls be stirred today, God. We need you and we want you and we invite you here. Anoint your word today. Open every heart and every ear and every mind. In Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen, amen. Amen. You might be seated for a moment. Hallelujah. David and Goliath. It's been a story in churches since the church was birthed. The story of the battle. And Israel and the Philistines have gathered together to fight. It's what's going on in the Middle East right now, like Brother Jim, they're getting ready. Something big is getting ready to happen. We've already read about it in Ezekiel. We've read about it in Daniel. It was prophesied. And then John the Revelator wrote it when he was carried up by the Spirit into heaven and began to write. It's all fulfilling. It's all coming to pass. They're gathering. But here in 1 Samuel, the Israelites and the Philistines have gathered together for a fight. And the Bible tells us that each one are encamped in a valley. And every day they would go out to battle. Every morning, the Bible tells us, Israel would leave the valley of Elah and they would climb to the top of the mountain. And then the Philistines were encamped in the valley of Shokah and they would climb their mountain every morning. And they would face each other. Now, please understand that there's three valleys in this story, and there's two mountains. There's this valley that Israel spends the night in, and then there's the mountain that they climb to, and then there's the valley that separates the two mountains and the two armies, and then there's this mountain that the Philistines stood on, and every night the Philistines would go back to their valley. So there's three valleys and two mountains in this story. And each morning, each nation would face each other separated by a valley. This went on for 40 days and 40 nights. Every morning they would arise, they would get ready, they would get all their armor, they would get their swords, they would get their slings, they would get their shields, they would grab their temporary tents to shelter them from the sun, they would get the chariots and the horses, and then every morning the Israelites would climb one side of the mountain, and then on the other mountain the Philistines would climb their side of the mountain. And for 40 days this activity went on. Now, 40 in the known scripture is the number of testing. It's a time of testing. You'll find in our lives there's times that we are tested, we are tried, we are tempted, there's tribulation. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Is anybody here today? It feels like that you're going under. It feels like that you just can't catch a break. It feels like that everything is falling apart. The Bible tells us it's a time of testing. You remember the flood? But after God told Noah to build an ark, and then God shut him in the ark, the Bible says it rained for 40 days and 40 nights. I appreciate the rain. I'm thankful for the rain. But there's something about the rain, why it waters the earth and cleanses the earth and refreshes the earth and gives us water to drink. There's something kind of depressing about it.
Amen.
Even the animals are depressed. Here, Noah is in the ark, and the Bible says it rained for 40 days and 40 nights. It was a time of testing for Noah. What would he do? Would he retreat back? Would he fall into depressing spirits? Would he cuss his wife out? Would he throw her overboard? What would he do? You remember Moses went up on Mount Sinai? How long was he there? Moses was on Mount Sinai for 40 days and 40 nights. It was a time of testing for God's people. And what would Israel do? Would Israel remain faithful? While the pastor's away, Would Israel remain faithful? While the voice of God was away, would they remain faithful? No, they didn't. They almost immediately forsook God and they worshiped a golden calf because they couldn't pass the test. And then they sent spies into the land of Canaan. You know how long the spies were in the land of Canaan? They were there for 40 days and 40 nights. 10 spies came back and said, "We can't do it. There's giants. We're like grasshoppers." And they brought fear, and the 40 years, 40 days of wandering turned into 40 years in the wilderness where generation died out. And so here, Israel's being tested. 40 days and 40 nights, every morning, every evening, the Bible says that the Philistines sent out their champion named Goliath. And I was caught by that word, champion. Why was Goliath called a champion? Did you know that in the Hebrew, the word champion means one who could decide the end result by himself? In Hebrew, the word champion means that with a single fight, the outcome is determined. In Hebrew, the word champion means someone who can control the outcome of a result. And so Goliath was their champion. They were putting all their stock that Goliath could handle it himself, that Goliath with a single fight could bring victory, that Goliath himself could control the outcome. In fact, Goliath brought fear into every heart in Israel's army. They were full of fear. They were stressed and they were worried. And so every day they would retreat back down the backside of the mountain that they had climbed that morning. The mighty warriors, the marksmen, the king, the bows, the guys that had the bows, the guy that has the spears, they would go to the top of the mountain and they would see the giant and fear would strike them and then they would retreat back because they were afraid. And because of fear, because they were afraid of the world's champion, because they were afraid of something bigger than they were, because they were afraid of something they did not understand, they retreated back down. They could not advance. They could not gain any ground. They just kept retreating and going back. And I believe that's where the Eifert Church of God is today. There's too many people. You stand out on the bow of your life and you see the enemy. You see the giant. You see the problem. And every day you retreat back to the place that you were at. You're not making any advances. Your life is just a vicious circle. You're not gaining any ground, and you're living a life of defeat and depression and discouragement, and you're living a life of retreat and defeat. Why? Because that giant looms over you. That giant is looming over you. So the question, what is your giant today? What is your Goliath? Because it's keeping you, keeping I from gaining any ground. We just keep climbing the same side of the mountain and then retreat back down the same side. Day after day, week after week, year after year. And every day that we arise, we see the giant, it looms over our life, it breathes threats, and so it keeps us down. It keeps us depressed. It keeps us in discouragement. Now verse 20 tells us, 1 Samuel chapter 17, I've never seen this before. It says that Israel went out to the fight, not to fight, but they went out to the fight. They didn't go up the mountain to fight. They went out to the place of the fight. They went to the place the battle was supposed to be. The problem is nobody would stand up to the giant. No one had the courage. Every day we go into the journey of life. Every day is a fight. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
But what is keeping you and I from fighting the good fight of faith? We go to the fight. What's keeping us from enduring? What's keeping us from running the race? Jesus said, strive. Strive in the Greek means to fight. Strive to enter by the narrow gate. You can't take anything into that gate but you. You can't take any unforgiveness. You can't take any bitterness. You can't take any sin. You can't take any bad feelings. You can't take any gossip. You can't take addictions. You can't take lust. You got to lay it all down. You got to turn sideways. You got to walk through the door, strive to enter the narrow gate. The Bible says, few find it. Many see it, few find it. You know why? Because every day of our life we go to the fight. But we don't fight the good fight of faith. Every day that a child goes to school, a young man or woman goes to college, you're entering into a battle. Does anybody work? Yes. When you get to work, it's a fight.
Amen.
It's a fight not to tell somebody off because they're lazy and don't want to work and they get the promotion. It's a fight every day when you're driving through traffic, people's cutting off, driving crazy, flipping you the bird.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes. It's a fight. It's a fight to live holy. It's a fight to read your Bible. It's a fight to pray. The problem is we show up to the fight, but there's no fight in us. There's no fight in us. And what happens is we've climbed the mountain, and we retreated back down the backside. That's the story of our life. We show up for church. Nothing ever changes. We go to the job. Nothing ever changes. We go back home to the spouse, and nothing ever changes. You know why? We've always made this a story about a boy named David and a giant named Goliath. But the battle is much more. The battle is more than about a giant and a boy. Because we're all going to have giants. Do you know what this story is really about? It's about who would possess the valley. You remember that the valley that the Philistines encamped in belonged to Judah? Judah had allowed something to come into their life that should not have? Does anybody remember what Judah means? Judah means tribe of praise. It was the tribe that worshipped. It was the tribe that led the procession because they worshiped God. They praised. They sang. They clapped. They had the timbrel and the harp. They had the flute. This was the tribe that praised and worshiped. The problem is Judah did not defend what belonged to them. And again, that's where the church is at today. We are so weak. We are so discouraged. We are so depressed. We have so much sin.
That's right. Amen.
And there are giants in our life. And every day we get up, I see a giant. I'm not going to make it. And so you retreat back down the mountain. You've lost all your strength. You've lost your joy. You've lost your faith. You've lost your hope. And you're not able to defend or fight for what God's given. What's God given? For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, He gave you Jesus. Are you defending Jesus? Are you defending Him? Well, preacher, He don't need no defense. If He's living in my heart, He does. Because He gave me a choice to do what I want, say what I want, go where I want. He gave me a fleshly body that's a fight every day. I got to put on this flesh suit. I got wants and desires that the flesh craves. But then when Jesus takes up residence in the throne of my heart, I walk a daily battle. I fight a daily fight. I run a daily race and I strive every day. And I'm going to defend and I'm going to protect the place that Jesus lives in my heart. I'm not going to let just any old thing get in my mind. I'm not going to let any old thing get in my heart because I've allowed Jesus to move in and I'm going to defend the place just like I'm going to defend this church. I'm going to defend my house. Defending what God's given you.
Yes. Amen.
Are you defending your salvation by not sinning? God's given you a ministry. If you're a Sunday school teacher, my prayer is you get on fire for God. Sunday school ought to be an exciting place.
Yes, amen.
It ought to be exciting. Those that are in a Sunday school class, they ought to look forward. They ought to look with excitement all week of going to Sunday school. Oh, it's quiet today in church. Is anybody with me today?
Amen.
I look forward to ministries at this church. I look forward to the second and fourth Saturday of climbing in the van and going out and passing out food, because it reminds me how blessed I am. I enjoy getting together on Thursday nights with the men. Whether it's 2 or 10. And just talking about man stuff, that we all got some problems. Yesterday on the van, we talked about how men are so selfish. And we are. We are a selfish creature. And it hinders marriages. It stops the move of God. It's a daily fight. You gotta fight it. And Judah had stopped defending the land that God had given them. Are you defending your home? Are you letting your children just read and listen to? And, well, preacher, I want them to be my best friend. Then you don't deserve to be a parent. Are you defending? Are you defending your spouse? You know, we won't let nobody talk about our mama, but we let people talk about our spouse. I had somebody come to church the other week that was bragging about how their spouse, my spouse has never said anything about me. I'm going, are we defending? Well, if God's given you a family, you need to defend it.
That's right.
Judah had stopped defending. Well, why? Why do we stop defending and fighting for things? Because we don't have any strength. Why don't we have any strength? Because we're terrified of the giant that stands before us. And we retreat. Israel had lost her praise. They had lost her place because they no longer worshiped God. They had surrendered back the valley that God gave them to the enemy. See, we don't like the valley. We like the mountaintop. Well, we, woo, shout. We got money in the bank, and the marriage is great, and the kids are listening. We just bought a new car, and the grass is perfect, and the sports team has won, and the doctor's report's good, and everything's wonderful, and you got exactly what you want to eat for supper. And you're up on the mountaintop, and they played your favorite song, and the temperature's just right, and you didn't fall all the way. Woo! I don't know about you, that don't happen very much in my life.
Amen.
I spend most of my life down in the valley. They had retreated, and because Israel was in a mess. This was a battle of praise. It wasn't a battle between necessarily a boy and a giant. Because if Judah had defended what God had given them, Goliath would have never been on the property.
Right.
You know, one of the reasons that giants come into our life, we open the door for them. What giant in your life has caused you to retreat? What giant has caused you to back up? What giant has stopped you from praising and praying and witnessing? What Goliath has beat you down so bad that you just keep retreating down that mountain? See, the enemy wanted this mountain. The Philistines hated the Israelites, and you can read it through history. There was a time where Israel and the Philistines got in a fight, and the Philistines whooped them. They did war different in Bible times. They would fight all day. They would swing swords and throw spears and cut heads and run over each other and swing slingshots. And then they'd count how many people had died. And then they'd go back to the tent at night. Then you'd wake up the next morning after drinking coffee and they'd sling some more spears and ride some more chariots and throw some more bow and arrows. And then they'd count the dead. And when somebody's lost everybody, they'd decide to be. After a battle one time between the Israelites and the Philistines had put a whooping on them, and about 20,000 people had died. But the Bible says that the Israelites went home, and they gathered around the Ark of the Covenant, around the tabernacle, and they began to praise God. Judah said, "We're not relinquishing, we're not retreating, we're not backing up." You can read it in the scripture. And so Judah led the praise, and the Philistines heard the noise of it, and they said, "This isn't the sound of defeat. This is the sound of victory." And they became afraid. And the next day the Israelites rose up and they went into the enemy's camp and they whooped the Philistines, and it started with some praise and some worship. And the reason that the Philistines wanted this land, they wanted to drive praise out. That's what the devil wants to do now. He wants to drive your praise out. He wants to drive your worship out. Oh, the devil don't mind you coming to church. In fact, he wants you to come to church and just have a scowl on your face and complain about everything and gossip about people and put people down. Oh, he loves that. And so what's happened, you allow the enemy to move into a place in your life that it don't belong, and he's pushed the praise out.
Yes. Amen.
The Philistines wanted to silence Judah. Has the enemy silenced you today? Another reason the Philistines wanted this valley. Because something very valuable, remember there's the valley that they encamped in, they'd go up the mountain. They'd look over the other mountain, there's a valley between, and the Philistines would look out and recruit. But in the valley in the middle, possess something extremely valuable for life. Between those two mountains that the two armies gathered, that the Philistines had now entered into land that didn't belong to them, the land that belonged to Judah. So the Philistines had silenced the praise of Israel. They wanted to advance to one more mountaintop, because if they advanced, then they would possess what was in the middle valley. Does anybody know what was in the middle valley? It was a crystal clear stream that provided fresh, cool water from the mountaintop. Now, I don't know about you, but there's nothing that satisfies my thirst like a glass of cool water. When I take a shower, it's the water and the soap that gets me clean. In fact, our body is made up mostly of water. See, water revives, water refreshes, water cleanses, water gives life. And maybe you have forgotten, since the giant has rose up in your life and praise has been silenced, maybe you can no longer see. So I came to tell you the truth today. Not only do we need to get praise back, but that water in the middle valley represents the flowing and the anointing of the Holy Ghost of God. And I'm tired of dry, dead, unservices where God can't move. And he can't move because we're giants in our life and we're paralyzed with fear. And we won't praise. And we won't worship. And we won't pray. And therefore the river can't flow. But I'm here to tell you today, I know God wants to infill. He wants to empower you with the power and the anointing. Where's the saints of God at in the church anymore? My God! Oh, I wish it was like it used to be. Well, you can make it like that today if you'll get some praise and open your mouth and let God flow in among you. Oh, hallelujah. Somebody give him a praise right now. Oh, Lord, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. But I got a bad doctor's report, but you alive. Ain't got no money, but you found a way to work. You had food on the table, got blows on your back. Sin and not living right, thank God he ain't killed him yet. And if there's breath, there's a chance. Hallelujah! Let everything that have breath praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah! Water represents the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
I don't fall from any denominations. I believe that. there's going to be folk from all denominations in heaven, just like there's going to be folks in all denominations in hell. What separates us is we're a holiness, full gospel, Bible believing, Holy Spirit preaching movement.
Amen.
But there's no revival, no refreshing. We've lost our thirst for God. Because we've allowed something to occupy a part of our life that God said, that's for me only. And the condition of Israel only grew worse. This day one. Day after day, they climbed up the backside of that mountain. They gathered up all their gear. Over and for 40 days they did that. Only to make it to the top of the mountain to hear and see the giant. Hear the threats. Hear the mockings, hear the cursings, and then they'd go back down the same side they climbed up. They became exhausted. Nobody would face the giant. I'd like to say, if that's the biggest word in the world, if I would have been there, Brother Jimmy, I'd have said, let's take that mountain. Sister Noel, I'd have said, let's take the mountain. Y'all looking at me like I'm crazy. I remember an 80-year-old man that stood and said, give me that mountain. Nobody would stand up. Nobody would fight. Nobody was brave enough. And what happened is they fell under the law of the champion. But that champion said, give me one man. I'd been like, listen, you from the world. I've got another God. I know Jesus. We're all coming after you. No. And that's what the devil's done to the church. The devil's divided the church. We sit in the same place. We talk to the same people. We do the same thing over and over. Somebody knew. Who is that? Why don't you go introduce yourself and talk to him? Because no one's willing to stand up. No one had enough faith. They had stopped telling the stories of God's deliverance. I will tell the older generation again. There's a younger generation growing up. They need to hear the stories of how God helped you, delivered you, blessed you, healed you. But you're not telling it because you're not here. When we go across the street. You're not there on Thursday night when the men gathered at 6:30. I told you, I'm going to tell you the truth today. I'll tell you that because I love you. I'm really not as mean as I look. I want you to go to heaven. And on the way there, I believe God wants you to live a victorious life. But nobody after 40 days and 40 nights, nobody would stand up and fight to him. Their praise had been hindered. The Holy Spirit had been hindered. What's hindering you today? Is it lust? Is it lust? Not just after a man or woman, things. How about life? I don't understand why people lie. I really don't, but people do. They lie over stupid stuff. I've asked people, have you had supper yet? Oh, yeah. And then find out later they hadn't. Why'd you lie about that? I don't understand. Maybe lying has hindered. Maybe worry has hindered you today. Maybe unforgiveness. Maybe bitterness, jealousy. Maybe money's hindered you. You allow money to hinder you. Maybe you have a rebellious spirit. Addictions. And what's happened is, doesn't mean you're a bad person. It means that you've allowed something to come into a place that God said, that's mine. You allowed the enemy to take over something that didn't belong to him. And so now you're fighting something and you're afraid of something and you won't stand up against that something, and now your praise has been stolen and the Holy Spirit flow has been stopped. So you start living in the past. You start being selfish with what you have, and then pride comes out. I don't need no help. I'm all right. But you're not. You cling to things like a job, a friend, possessions. But I'm thankful that in this story of two mountains and three valleys, the battle is deeper than a boy and a man. The battle is about who had possessed the valley. But I'm glad that after 40 days and 40 nights of Israel's falling into chaos and they're blaming each other and they're warring against each other and they're divided, I'm glad that a little shepherd boy called and chosen and anointed by God, I'm glad he showed up. There was something different about this young man. Oh, and while the Philistines had their champion, you remember what champion meant? Champion meant one, it meant middleman. It meant one that could decide the result himself. A champion meant that with a single fight, and while the Philistines had their champion, David had been introduced to the great champion, the great I Am, Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Nissi, Jehovah Shalom. Oh, he had been introduced while he was on the backside of a mountain, while he was tending some stinky, dirty, rotten, disobedient sheep. He began to write praises unto God, and he wasn't going to let a lion take his sheep or his praise. He wasn't going to let a bear take his sheep or his praise. He wasn't going to let living life alone. He wasn't going to be worried about being an outcast. He wasn't concerned about what everybody else was doing. He was only saying, Lord, while I'm watching these sheep, I'm going to give you praise. I'm going to worship you. See, that shepherd boy didn't know about a champion. He knew the champion. He knew that God could determine the outcome at a thought, at a touch, at a voice. He knew that the deliverer and the champion had watched over him, had provided for him, had delivered him in the good times and the bad. David knew the Lord. That's why he wrote in Psalms 23, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. It's why he wrote another song, the Lord is my fortress. He said he is my rock. He is my shelter. He is my shield. David was a praise and worshiper of God, and he was led by the Spirit. So here was a young boy that everybody overlooked. People had forgotten about him. When he showed up and he heard, they made fun. They got mad. The Bible says that David was offended. He said, who is this uncircumcised Philistine? The uncircumcision meant more than the cutting away of foreskin. In the Old Testament, if you was uncircumcised, you was unclean. You couldn't be a part. You was a heathen. And there was a little shepherd boy. He saw and said, who is this uncircumcised heathen that's talking about my champion? My God. But David said, look, ain't none of y'all standing up. Ain't none of y'all going to do nothing. Y'all just going to keep retreating and then talk about everybody else. And say, look, David said, I'll stand up. David said, I'll go. David said, I'll fight. You know why? Because David had walked upright before God. The Bible tells us that he always behaved wisely. You know why? Because David didn't do anything that would stop his praise or stop the flow of the river. You know, when you walk right and your worship is right, your warfare will be right. I want to say it again. When you walk holy before God and you live right, when your walk is right and your worship is right, when it's time for warfare, the warfare will be right. Victory will come. So the question today is, what's your giant? What has stopped your praise? What has stopped the flowing of the Holy Spirit? It's time to stand up against the giants in our life. That giant is hindering you from moving forward. That giant that on Sunday morning and Sunday night or during the week, it silences the lips of praise. It stops the move of God. Too many people are like those Israelites. up and down, up the same path, the same tract of land. And every day you see a giant, but you won't deal with it. You won't face it. Fear is coming in. You know what we need today? We need some honesty where men and women will say, I admit, I got some giants. And pastor, they've been there so long, I'm bound by it. I want to kill it. And we don't deal with the giants of our life, and we allow things that come into what God's given us. And God gave you a body. He gave you a mind. He gave you a family. He gave you stuff. When God gives you things, don't let the enemy possess what's not his. That's what Israel did. That's where this battle started. And so life becomes an ugly circle of depression, anger, and jealousy, and bitterness, and unforgiveness. And it leads to uncommitment. Where's the commitment today in the church? The Bible says that God's going to only hold that that was committed to him against that day. The commitment's waning. We find every reason to miss church. Every reason to not read, not pray, not witness. And it's not that we need those things to keep us saved. We need those things to give us strength. Amen. To fight, to walk, Amen. To strive, to learn. We need to stop retreating, people. As the music plays and you stand today, what's your giant?